It is indeed a great pleasure to see such an enthusiastic participation of our young friends in this classroom series on mediation. At EMW, we have designed the topics on mediation strictly in accordance with the syllabus of mediation prescribed by the Bar Council of India. Our guest teachers are senior mediators and trainers who are domain experts and have vast experience in mediation training. So therefore, my suggestion to all my young friends is to not to miss this classroom series at all, as this is going to be greatly benefited to all. The ground rules of the classroom series have already been informed to you in the earlier inaugural class. But however, for the same purposes, I would request our student moderator today, Paurimi Chakravarti, to give her brief introduction and inform us about the ground rules of the classroom. Paurimi, over to you. Thank
you. Good afternoon to everyone, respected Jawad sir, Anup sir, Pushp madam, Thankanjan sir, and all my fellow mates. I am Paurimi Chakravarti from ICFAI University, Tripura. Currently pursuing my BBA LLB 5 years integrated course. I am the student moderator for today's session, and the rules and regulations for today's sessions are each and every participants are requested to keep their camera on and their mic off throughout the session. There shall be a question answer round at the end of the session, and at the end I will ask each and every students to in the chat box to drop their name in the chat box. Those who are having any queries, they can drop their name in the chat box, and at the end I will read out their name, and at the end they can unmute themselves and ask question to sir. That's all for today's rules and regulations. Thanking you all. Now I would like to hand over the platform to Anup sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Paurimi, so much. So according to the rules, as Paurimi has said, I would request everyone to keep their cameras on. That will be a good way to interact with all of you. So it is our indeed great privilege to all of us to have with us Sri A.J. Jawad sir as a teacher speaker of today's topic with us. So here's a brief introduction of it. Jawad sir, as we fondly call him, got enrolled as an advocate in the year 1988. And started practicing in the High Court at Chennai. Jawad sir has been a mediator since 2007. He has an extensive experience in mediating commercial, contractual, matrimonial, and child custody cases. He is a master trainer with the Mediation and Conciliation Project Committee, MCPC Supreme Court. He has trained lawyers and judges in mediation all over India and has been conducting training of trainers workshop for the MCPC. Jawad sir works for ADR ODR International United Kingdom as a mediator, and as global faculty he has been involved in mediation training program in universities in UK and India as well. He is a partner and head of the ADR services with Cadillacs Chambers, a firm offering range of ADR services. He is a specialist guest faculty with the Maharashtra National Law University. He is empaneled as India specialist mediator with SIMMC and is accredited as a level 3 mediator with SIMI. He is empaneled as a mediator with Bombay Chambers of Commerce and also empaneled as an arbitrator with the Madras High Court Arbitration Center. So there's I think much more to it. I'm cut shorting it a little bit. So Jawad sir has been my mentor too. That is also very important to me. He is one of the most dashing mediator trainer I have come across, and he is very popular with his pupil also. So he has an extensive knowledge and experience in the field of mediation. Our EMW family has a great love and respect for him, and we welcome you, sir. Before I invite Jawad sir for his deliberation on today's topic, let me briefly recap the topic of conflict, which was discussed in the last class for the benefit of all those who were absent on the last class. So Sushila ma'am took that topic, and she had very lucidly given you a clear understanding about conflict, its causes, and resolution. She said, dispute is a result of unmet needs. Conflict involves long-term serious disagreement, which causes constant discomfort to the person who is involved in conflict. Conflict situation arises when needs, interest, values, and goals of one person gets threatened by needs, interest, values, and goals of another person. Conflict is a kind of a competition between perceived and actual threats. Conflict can be managed, it can be handled, addressed, or resolved. But there's an advice that do not avoid conflict. She also told us about the elements of conflict. There were four elements as per her: opposing interest between two parties, when the parties are opposing, have opposing interests against each other. Then recognition of such opposition. Third is belief that other will interfere with my interest. These are all threat perceptions. Actions that reinforces such interference. So these are the four elements which she told us. Then she also told us about the types of conflict. She explained us two types of conflict. First was intrapersonal. Intrapersonal is a kind of conflict which is within the individual, when the individual is in conflict within himself. And there is then interpersonal conflict, and this is a conflict between two individuals. So she also told us about the Guy Harris concept on escalation of conflict. She told us that it escalates, how the conflict escalates. It starts with perceiving threat. Then once you perceive threat, you start getting angry with high emotions, and then you start reacting. And the same thing actually is happening with the other person with which you are in conflict. So he is also perceiving threat, getting angry and reacting, and this escalates the conflict situation. So there are de-escalation process also which she has informed us. First one is to listen carefully. Second is to acknowledge feelings and emotions of the other party. Third is apologize for your contribution in escalating the conflict. And then fourth is control your tone and body language. And of course, five is to focus on the future. When people start focusing on future, okay, conflict situation reduces. She also told us about the conflict resolution approach. She called it Staben approach, which is a term coined by Dr. Jenny Band. So Staben is an acronym. S stands for source of conflict. T stands for time and place of the conflict resolution, which one chooses. A stands for amicable approach, that is appreciating the other party for his role, being empathetic. Then B stands for behavior, identifying the behavior. E stands for emotions, understanding the emotions of the other party. And N stands for needs. So one has to understand and acknowledge the needs of the other party. So these are the resolution method of conflict. So she briefly told us about the role of society in conflict resolution, and also other modes of dispute resolution, wherein she told us about negotiation, mediation, arbitration, and adjudication. So these were the small recap, a brief recap of what we have done in the last class. Now from the discussion which we have just done, it can be fairly concluded that in order to resolve a conflict situation, one needs to possess very good communication skills, right? So what is communication and what are the communication skills shall now be explained by our learned teacher speaker, Shri A.J. Jawad sir. So over to you, Jawad sir. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you, Anup, for summarizing what Sushila ma'am had taught last time.
Yes.
I somehow missed it because I was not here. So it was quite a lot of new concepts have been taught by her. Love to attend that. And I would request Thangachan to share a recording if he has that, because it would be a learning experience.
It is.
So friends, welcome to all of you. As Anup said that, when we have conflict and when we need to resolve, we need to communicate with each other, right? So when you talk about, thing I want to say, because among the ground rules, I think Polami said that you can only ask the questions in the end. Okay, that I have a little difficulty with that. So I would request all of you to ask me questions whenever any question, any doubt arises in your mind. Okay, and I would prefer this to be an interactive session. Not a monologue from my side. Okay, so I may be asking you questions and I want you to also ask me questions. Okay, so, but just make sure that the questions are relevant to the matter that we are discussing at that point of time, because you may be having some doubts about some larger issues or about something else, which you can reserve for the last. Okay, because if you bring up a question that is not pertinent to the point that we are discussing, then it will get, we may get digressed. And I have this habit of not letting any question go unanswered. So if I go into that, then we'll be digressing. So please make sure that your question is pertinent to what the point that we will be discussing at that point of time. Okay. Okay, so I want to switch to gallery. So my question to all of you is, when we say communication, what do you understand about that? I mean, what comes to your mind, or what do you think of communication? Yes, please, Dipshika. You can unmute yourself. Who can? I think there's a problem in unmuting. I see 3-4 hands up. I see Palomi's hand up. I see Dipshika wanted to say something. And then
Tanjan sir, can we unmute all of them?
Yes, yes. Yes, I'm doing it. So you can unmute and now you can ask questions. Yes, please.
Okay, very interesting. I see a lot of hands up. So I'll start with, I think the first person to raise the hand was Dipshika. So Dipshika.
Sir, thank you, sir. So it is the way of interacting with the people.
The way of interacting.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, that's a point to be noted. What about anybody else? Follow me, you wanted to say something?
Sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, communication is the sharing of views and thoughts of one person to other.
Very good. So you share your views and thoughts through the process of communication. Excellent. Who else?
Sir, communication is like understanding what the other person is telling us and communicating, giving the answer. This is Deepthi, sir.
Okay. Would you mind just mentioning your name, because there are 108 of you here. I won't know who's talking, because sometimes I may not be able to see the screen. Usually the yellow border that comes.
Okay, sir. So communication, to my knowledge, is like understanding what the other person is telling us and replying back with the proper answer. Okay. This is what I understand.
Very good. Anybody else?
Sir, this is Devaki Reddy.
Yeah.
Communication means it is imparting and exchanging of information, either receiving it or by giving the information, thereby what we are planning to talk to them or what we are ready to receive from them. It's a kind of a friendly communication, I mean, friendly exchange of things.
Mm-hmm.
What is the outcome of our meeting or whatever?
Is communication always friendly?
No, it's not. It's not like this. But we should be polite with the other person by exchanging this information.
That is an expectation. Okay, that's an expectation. Yes. But it
this
may
is
not
because,
be...
but if you are not polite or friendly, yeah. the yeah. other person may not be in a position to receive it. He may be in a negative feeling. So. Yeah. Always we have to be polite in sending
so
our information.
What you're saying, Devaki, is that the ideal way of communication is to be polite when you're talking to somebody, right? When you're
Yes, it should be polite.
Yes, very good. So who else wants to say?
Good afternoon, sir. This is Kritika.
Yeah, Kritika.
Communication is
those who have answered, can you put your hands down because it's confusing.
Communication is where we interact with each other and share our thoughts, feelings, so that we can improve our speaking skills as well as thinking process also improves.
Yeah.
And we can study their mindsets.
Okay, very good. So let me just sum up. So what all of you have said is, it's basically a process by which we understand others and we help others to understand what we are trying to say. And it is basically a back and forth exchange of, either words or by any other means of communication that we may be using. The essence of communication is to be able to understand each other, right? Would you agree with that proposition? That basically it's to understand each other, right? Any disagreement on that?
No, sir.
Okay. So, right. Now, what I will do is I'll just share the screen with you and let's see how we can take it forward. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, okay, before I start the PowerPoint, I just want to ask you, when I say communication, what are the different ways of communication that strike you in your mind? One is speaking with words, right? Talking with using words. Anything else that you can
electronic
think?
Communication.
Non-verbal, like hand gestures.
One by one.
Maybe by the written information we can exchange.
Through
or
writing.
By the messages. Through writing.
So basically, words, either spoken or written, we can exchange. It can be
hand
done for electronic medium.
Hand gestures, sir.
So body language.
So body language.
Non-verbal communication.
Sign. Very good. Yeah. Body language then.
Sign. I mean. The way of behavior.
Just yeah, body gesture is also body gestures also very important aspect.
Yes.
Whether a person is ready to listen to us or not.
Correct.
Signs and symbols.
Signs and symbols also are ways of communicating with each other. Very good. Right. Now, the types of communication when you see, as far as human beings are concerned, let us understand one thing. We are basically animals who can speak, right? There's no difference between animals and us, except that we have the power of language. We know how to speak, right? We use words. So much of our communication is verbal because we use words to describe whatever we want to say. But there's also something called tone of voice, like how we express ourselves. Okay. Now, I just want all of you to close your eyes, okay? And I'm going to be speaking to each one of you. So you think that I'm going to be talking to each one of you. Now, this might be a little offensive, but it's not meant to, you know, offend you in any way. But it is just to show you, you know, how the tone of voice can make a difference. Okay, just close your eyes. And imagine that your boss or your teacher or somebody is talking to you, or your father or somebody is talking to you. Okay, just close your eyes. You fool! Open your eyes. How did you feel?
Angry.
Yeah?
We feel offensive.
You feel offended?
Yes, sir. It was offensive.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, now just reset your minds. Okay, and close your eyes again. And now I'm your friend or somebody whom you like and who likes you. Okay? You fool. How do you feel now?
It's a kind of joking with a close relation between the friends. We're just casually saying, like, you know, you fool, this is not this, that, and all. Out of love, yes. Also, we can utter such things.
Yes.
On so the module of, I mean, the tone of the voice and the module makes a lot of difference.
So it makes a lot of difference. The tone of voice makes a lot of difference. And of course, the body language. Okay. So, now there was a gentleman called Albert Mehrabian. Okay. Now he said that in our communication, we use only 7% of the words. Okay. So it's only the words that we use constitute only 7%. So now you, and 38% is the tonality, the kind of tone of voice that you use. Now you notice that I use the same words, you fool. And the way I said it, the tone of my voice, in the first instance, you found it to be offensive. Potentially, you may have got angry, perhaps. And you would have said, this guy starts off the class by calling us as fools. What nonsense is this? Okay, why should we sit here and get insulted? So there's a possibility that you may have, perhaps you may have thought that way. But the next time when I said the same words, the tone of my voice showed you, okay, here's a person who, you know, is jokingly telling us, you know, because of something that we did. There's a lot of love and affection in the voice, and it's not meant to really say that we are fools, but it is something to, you know, he's jokingly just saying something in a lighter way. Now, the rest of it is, of course, the body language, the physiology, how I say those words, how my... Like, I'll give you an example of, let's say somebody, imagine you're going to somebody's house and the guest is offering you a seat. I mean, the host is offering you a seat and you're sitting there and you find the seat to be very uncomfortable and you're shifting and moving and, you know, you're very uneasy. And the host asks you, for example, Dipshika, are you comfortable? And you're a very polite person. Dipshika is a very polite girl and she doesn't like to offend her host. So she says, yeah, I'm okay. Right? But she's shifting and she's very uneasy. And, you know, you can make out from her face, she's grimacing and all that. And then another scene where, you know, maybe Samriddhi goes to somebody's house and I'm just mentioning the names that are there on my screen. Okay. I'm not being partial to anybody. So, she goes to somebody's house and the chair is offered. She's very comfortable. She's sitting and the host asks, Samriddhi, are you okay? And she says, yeah, I'm okay. So here the tone of voice changes, the body language changes. So it conveys a completely different meaning. Okay. Now, I have written a sentence over there. I never sold that horse to you. Now, one by one, okay, you can, any of you tell me what meaning does it convey to those words? What meaning do they convey to?
Sir, can you please repeat again the question, please?
No, I have, there is a sentence that you can see on the screen. I never sold that horse to you. Can you see it, sir, on my screen? Yes. On the slide, can you see that? I never sold that horse to you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. We can see it.
Tell me, what's the meaning of that? What do you understand from that sentence?
Means he did not sell the horse to the particular person to whomsoever he is answering.
Very good. So he did not sell the horse, correct?
He did not sell it.
Yeah. So, any other meaning?
So, there might be a particular There might be a particular pitch that he's talking about, that the fact that he did not sell that particular pitch to a particular person. That might be one case.
Pitch means, you mean some other meaning? That...
As in a proposal, I believe.
Okay.
So if me and you have a contract, in that case, there might be a particular circumstance where I say that you claim that I said a particular thing, and when I refuse to it, I say that I never sold that horse to you.
Very good. So I never sold that horse to you, right? That's the meaning. Good. That is the second meaning. But any other meanings?
Excuse me, sir. Sri Lagna here.
Excuse me?
No, 1 minute. Sri Lagna. Yes, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, can we interpret it this way, that you were trying to communicate something in some manner, but that did not reach the other person the way you wanted it to? So that's why you did not want to sell that horse. But I mean, yeah, that is what I interpreted out of it.
Yeah. So Sri Lagna, you're right. Now, that is what I want you to tell me. How do you understand this? This is my sentence. Okay. I have written this in my email or in my notice or something to you, and you're reading it, and how do you understand this?
Sir, I think that there is a difference, like there is a gap in the communication, and I could not get something that you were trying to convey in the message earlier, and
what's
I need
point?
To see
why, it. Why is it? Why is it? Why do you feel confused about what I'm trying to tell you?
Because it's not very clear onto what you're trying to say to me.
It's very clear. It's a simple sentence. I never sold the toss to you. See, now two different meanings had come, okay? So one was that I never sold the horse to you, and I never sold the horse to you. So those are two different meanings. Any other meaning? Somebody
hello.
Else want
to say? Hello? Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, who's this?
This is Senorita, sir.
Yes,
so maybe this person is defending himself by the question which was asked to him, whether that whether he sold the horse or not. So maybe he's defending it. Maybe his sort of way of telling the answer, no, I did not sell the horse to you.
Very good. So I did not. He's denying that, right? So there is a denial. Okay, very good. And what about Paul? Paul wants to say something. I see your hand up. Paul?
Yes, sir. Hello. Hello, sir.
Yeah, Paul.
Yeah, sir. According to me, it means that he might have sold some other horse, but not that particular horse.
Very good. Very good.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Okay, now what I found is each one of you is coming up with different meanings, completely different meanings. Okay, that those meanings that you're giving me change the whole context in each case, right? Now, how do you know which is the correct? How do you know what is it that I'm trying to say?
So the tone of...
The tone is little angry.
The tone in
angrier.
Which that sentence is spoken will
yes, exactly.
tell you what is the context of that particular sentence.
Exactly. Yes. Very good. So now you can see that in this one sentence, I can draw 6 different meanings. Like if I say, I never sold the horse to you. Senorita sold the horse to you. Right? I never sold the horse to you. I never sold the horse to you. Okay, I have never sold a horse. Right? I never sold the horse to you. I gave it to you as a gift, or maybe you stole it from me. I never sold the horse to you. I did not get money for it. So it was not a sale. I never sold that horse to you. I sold you a different horse. I sold you a black horse. Now you're showing me a white horse. I never sold that horse to you. Maybe I sold you a donkey, or maybe I sold you a cow or a buffalo or anything, but I never sold that horse to you, or maybe even a bike, right? I never sold that horse to you. Okay, Samriddhi, I didn't sell it to you. I sold it to Shaikh, right? So you see how the tone changes the whole meaning. So if you're going to read a sentence and you're going to, so the words, how insignificant the words are or how incomplete the words can be, if you don't have the context in which somebody is speaking, or if you're not going to hear the tone of voice to understand what is the context of that. So do we agree now that, okay, Mehrabian principle has come up for a lot of criticism? People have said, you know, that it depends on the culture, it depends on so many other, it depends on the context, it depends on various other factors. But more or less, we can agree that 7% is words and 93% is how we say those words. Right? Have you agreed on that? Yes?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now we come to what is body language. Okay. Now, according to my guru, Joel Lee, he says it's only a metaphor that gives the impression that one's body signals or communicates content which is similar to words and sentences. Okay. So when we are looking at body language of somebody and we are trying to draw a meaning of it, from it, we are just trying to be, we are applying what is called as an interpretive model. We are trying to understand, okay, so this person is looking here and there, eyes are shifting, and hands, they are being very nervous, they are just, you know, wringing their hands together. So maybe they are not, this person is not telling the truth. So we interpret that. But there is the risk over there, okay, because what happens is many times, some people have a habit of doing certain things, okay? Some hand movements. Like if you look at me, even though we are across a digital divide, I still have the habit of, you know, my hands. I'll be waving my hands all over the screen, okay? So sometimes it can even be distracting for you. If it is distracting, you tell me, I'll try to keep my hands down. But I'm very comfortable when I'm shaking my hands. So, now, if somebody thinks that, you know, I'm being nervous, okay, this fellow is nervous, so, you know, he's going on shaking his hands and talking, or he's being very expressive or anything, but you don't know what exactly I'm feeling. So, by trying to interpret my body language and trying to associate that with my words, you may be making a mistake. So, what normally experts say is that to interpret body language, you need to understand three things. Okay, one is the culture where the person comes from. Like, for example, if you're talking to somebody who's from the West, somebody who's white or black or brown doesn't make any difference, but the culture where the person has grown up, a shrug of shoulders might convey a lot of meaning, okay? It might be get lost or I don't care or so what. Okay, so it can mean anything. But if you come to our Eastern culture, we are more expressive over there. Okay, we may the shrug of the shoulders may be accompanied by so many other things. So if you're used to one culture and you go to another culture, you need to be aware that okay, we need to be aware of the cultural context of the body language. So, for example, I don't know how many of you have watched Fluffy videos. His name is Gabriel something, no? Iglesias or something. Have you heard or watched his videos on YouTube?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So he talks about how Indians, Mexicans, and how others speak. Okay, he talks about the body language. Like the Indians have the habit of shaking the head, and Mexicans shake the head like this. So the culture varies. The second aspect is the context. So in what context are you seeing that body language? Is that person, like, for example, if somebody is caught lying or somebody is cornered with some information that may not be, you know, suitable for that person, or somebody feels that they're being cornered, they'll reach for the throat. Okay, now reaching for the throat is a very primitive kind of response that we give because, you know, predators usually reach for the throat. If you see a tiger or a lion attacking, they'll reach for the throat. So we have this very primitive kind of a response where we feel a constriction in our throat whenever we come across something which is very troubling for us, where we feel that we have been cornered or we feel that we have been sort of, you know, a tight situation where we are not able to escape from it. So if somebody is wearing a coat and a tie and all that, they will try to loosen it a bit. So you would have seen all these body languages, okay? So the context is very important. What context is the person displaying a particular body language? The third important thing they say is when you're interpreting body language, don't look at any one thing. Okay. Don't just look at the hands and say that this person is nervous. Also look at the eyes, look at the way the person is sitting. So it's always a cluster of cues, cluster of signals that you need to look at, not any one signal and then decide, because you may be misled into misunderstanding what the person is actually trying to do or say. So it's always a cluster. And so you need to be aware of the culture, you need to be aware of the context, and you need to be looking for the cluster of cues that you're getting from the person when you're trying to interpret body language. So body language is essentially what Joel Lee says, it's a metaphor, because being animals, and the only difference being that we use words, we have language, but otherwise we respond with our body language. Like if a dog is very happy looking at you, the dog will wag its tail. If a cat doesn't like you, cat is going to wag its tail. Now, my daughter gave a beautiful description of how a dog thinks and how a cat thinks. So I don't know how many of you are dog lovers and cat lovers. We have a cat at home. So she said a dog will look at you and think that, okay, this person is giving me food, giving me shelter, taking care of me. So this person must be God. Now cats think a little differently. So cats think, okay, this person is taking care of me, giving me food, giving me a house to live in. So I must be God. Okay, so that's how cats and animals, I mean, dogs think. So you see how the difference between the same feline related species, actually, both are felines. And you see how the difference, they are canines and felines, but whatever it is, I don't know, I'm not much of a biology student. But if you're used to seeing only a dog, like imagine you're living in a country where you don't have cats at all, and you have only dogs. And you're used to, you know, seeing the dog wagging its tail because when the dog is happy, and you go to a place where there's a lion or a tiger, and the tiger is wagging its tail, and you think that, okay, this tiger is very pleased with me because it's wagging its tail, because you're used to only two dogs wagging their tails and they're pleased. So you go near the tiger and try to pet it, it'll probably eat you up. So you have to be very careful. That same thing applies to even body language. So it varies in different cultures, it varies in different contexts, and you need to look at the cluster, okay. Now, what is it that actually makes this thing called body language? Basically our emotions, okay. So if you look at our emotions, we have different kinds of emotions. We have anger. So when you look at somebody, you can make out whether that person is angry or what. When you look at somebody, you can see that this person is sad. Or when you feel fear, your body language, your facial expressions might be different. When you're enjoying something, your facial expressions might be different. When you're in love or you're loving somebody, or you feel the emotion of love towards someone, then it will be different. We'll see what is the physiology of all these things we'll be seeing. So surprise, disgust, shame. So in each of these things, your body language varies. So you can, to a substantial extent, make out that, okay, this person is feeling like this. But then again, as I said, you have to look at the cluster. Now, if you look, for example, anger. You see the person's angry face, you know how it is. You can see that the fist is raised and the mouth is open and the eyes are fierce. So what actually happens is the blood flows to the hands. So automatically you clench your hands because you want to either punch somebody or grasp a weapon. So you're ready to strike at your enemy. And there is a rush of adrenaline. You feel full of, you know, action, like you want to go and hit somebody, do something like that. So when you feel fear, the blood goes to your skeletal muscles. So it makes it easy for you to run from there. When you're scared, you want to run from there. So the face becomes dry because the blood gets diverted from the face into the body. So sometimes you may even freeze out of fear because the fear will be so overpowering that you may not be able to run. So it actually, what happens is the brain triggers a flood of hormones, which puts the body on a general alert. So the hormones that are operating there in controlling these emotions and your body, the body expressions that you're demonstrating is adrenaline and noradrenaline. Similarly, if you see happiness, what actually happens is there is an increased activity in the brain center that all negative feelings get inhibited. You feel a lot of energy. You feel like doing a lot of things, you know, jumping around and shouting and, you know, whooping and laughing. And you recover very fast, even if something at that moment when you're very happy, let's say that you trip and fall, you don't much bother about that. Like you just get up, dust yourself and you continue to be happy. So there's always the readiness and enthusiasm to do things. So the hormone operating there is dopamine. Now, when you feel love, tender feelings, you know, relaxed, you feel very relaxed, you feel that calm and contented feeling. Of course, if you don't know whether the girl or boy loves you in return, you might be a little tensed up. But love does not have to be always, you know, between, there are different kinds of love, like filial love is there between brothers and sisters, paternal love is there, then we have platonic love between friends, and then we have erotic love between lovers. So you get that fuzzy, warm, fuzzy feeling and you're very relaxed and you feel happy about it. And then the hormone that is working on you is oxytocin. So these are, you know, the next is, you know, when you see, when you're surprised, okay, when you lift your eyebrows, your eyes become bigger and you're trying to, you know, take in the larger picture, because this is all, you know, something to do with evolution, the way we have evolved. Because these are all very primitive responses that we have in our body. Because when you're surprised, something suddenly you see something which surprises you, which takes you by surprise. You automatically try to get in as much information about that. This all happens without thinking. Your brain triggers that response. So your eyes wide open wide because you want to let in more light. So you want to see what is happening around you. So this offers you more information about the unexpected thing that has happened. Now, disgust, when you like, when you smell something which is very bad or you taste something that is very bad, again, then your nose wrinkles and your lips curl. So this is basically, again, you know, according to Darwin, it is a primordial attempt to either close the nostrils to prevent any, you know, bad smell from going inside or to spit out the poisonous food. Then we have sadness. So sadness is usually, you know, when we lose something or somebody who's close to us, or we come across a major disappointment in life. So we feel sad. So there's a drop in energy. There's a, you know, there's no enthusiasm for any activities. Especially we don't like to do anything that will be good for us, like which will give us some pleasure. So we try to avoid that because we are depressed. And the body's metabolism comes down. So we stop eating food. So we don't feel like talking to anybody, we withdraw. So this is, you know, the most probably what I'm trying to say is that this could have been a way of, like, suppose in those good old days when we were hunters and gatherers, if somebody got killed by a wild animal and everybody felt sad, they would not venture out. They will not be exposed to danger. So they would be closer to home. So that is the way, that was one of our means of survival, right? Okay, now let's come to the most important aspect of communication. So any questions so far? So what we discussed today, let me just sum up till now what we discussed. We discussed that communication is basically to understand each other, what we are trying to convey and what the other person is trying to convey. So we need to understand that. And in order to be able to understand that, we have found out that though we are basically animals and we have the, but with the power of language, with the power of the spoken word, it may still not convey the whole meaning because there might be, you know, the words may convey only a small percentage of what we are trying to say. So we need to look out for some other clues, like what is the tone of voice in which the words are being uttered? Or what is the way in which the body is or how the person is speaking those words. So that's very important. So we need to understand that. Okay, so without understanding that, we may not be able to find out what actually is the meaning of what is being conveyed to us. Then we also saw that body language is only an interpretive model. So we are trying to understand from the body language what the person is saying, but there are some caveats over there. The caveats are that we need to look out for the culture, we need to look out for the context, and we need to look out for the cluster. And then we saw how emotions can, you know, be conveyed through our body language, and how we can look at the person and probably understand by looking at the whole cluster of what the person is saying or doing, whether the person is angry or sad or, you know, happy or in love or whatever it is. So any questions so far? No?
Sir, I have a question.
Yes,
sir. Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Tell me.
Yeah. So my question is, we have different modes of communication since we communicate through messages and emails. But we send someone an email, but there is no body language, no tone.
Yes.
So how we are going to interpret that?
It's a very good question. What's your name? I'm sorry, I'm not able to see your name.
My name is Eamon.
Eamon, that's a very good question. I'll come to that because that is part of this today's discussion. Okay. Because today we are living in a digital world and we have challenges because much of our communication is through WhatsApp, it's through short messages, it's through emails, right? So that is very important for us to discuss that also. Now we are talking about the physical setting because in all probability, the pandemic may not continue forever and we may be getting back to a more physical setting. So we'll get this out of the way and then we will go into the digital, you know, what is called as digital body language. Okay. So what are the problems with digital communication and how you should communicate digitally? And that is something that I would like to learn from you guys because David Prinsky told in 2001, as early as in 2001, that oldies like me are digital immigrants. Whereas you guys are digital natives. So you were born and brought up here. Like for example, if supposing somebody from France comes to India or Pakistan and tries to speak Hindi, you can make out that this person is not from here, right? It's not, he's not a native. But if a person from there, who's domiciled there would speak, you know that, okay, this is the local person. So you are the digital natives and we are the immigrants. Okay, so though we will be discussing that, there's a lot I would like to learn from you when it comes to digital communication. Okay.
Sir, we are getting help from emojis and WhatsApp stickers and all that. Otherwise, we don't understand.
Yeah, yeah. So I realized how important these emojis are because I always get confused with the emojis, which emoji says what. So now I'm just beginning to figure it out and I always use emojis because I know that, you know, sometimes my words may be misconstrued, so therefore a smiling emoji or a folded hands emoji or something like that may help to convey a different message. So that's a good question, Eamon. We'll come to that. Okay, let's get this out of the way first. Okay.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Thank you.
So basically, see the objective. What is the objective of communication? If you look at it particularly from the mediation context, and why only mediation context, even generally from the perspective of how communication should be between two people. Essentially, the purpose of communication is to build rapport, right? It's to build rapport, right? You understand what I mean by saying you build rapport?
Sir.
Yeah, establish a level of comfort and understanding between two people. Some level of trust and confidence and, you know, so that we can talk to each other and understand each other better. So that is what is called as building of rapport, R-A-P-P-O-R-T. Some people pronounce it as rapport, but it is rapport. So the whole idea is to build rapport. Now, the challenge comes when you're communicating with more than one person. So there's a difference between communicating on a one-to-one basis and communicating with two or more people, particularly in the mediation context. Because in the mediation context, you're going to be sitting and talking to maybe two people, maybe three people, their lawyers will be there, parties will be there, parties' representatives might be there, relatives might be there. So how do you show that, you know, you are connected to each one of them and you're equally placed towards each one of them, or you're impartial towards each one of them? Okay. So that, what they say is that it's important that how you space yourself. Okay, so if there are, let's say, two people, if you see this picture, for example, you see the distance between the two, between the three of them. There's one person sitting in the middle, obviously he's the mediator, and there are two people who are sitting there in front of him. Now, if you see that there is an equal distance, the spacing is equal from each one of them. And if you see his body language, his hands are open, he's not closing himself. But again, you know, if supposing somebody closes the arms like this, not, doesn't necessarily mean that he or she is closing themselves to you. It can also mean that they're feeling cold. So that is why I said that you need to watch out for clusters. So you have to be very careful when interpreting. So when you're looking at him, but you feel, you find that this person is open, okay? So there are open gestures and there's a slight leaning forward, not falling over the table or not falling over the, or all over the other people who are there, but there is a certain amount of leaning forward and there is eye contact. Now, because this is not a video, this is a picture, but you can see that even though one person is talking to the other person, the third person, the middle person, is looking at the person who's speaking. So whether you're somebody speaking to me or speaking to somebody else, normally it is good to maintain eye contact with the person who's speaking. And you can see that, you know, though these two seem to be a little tensed up, the middle person, who's obviously the mediator, is very relaxed. So we sometimes have mirroring neurons in our mind. Okay, so when you are relaxed, automatically that passes on to the other person also. So even if people are tensed up, they may start mirroring your actions or gestures and they may start relaxing. So solar is very important. This solar principle, please keep it in mind that it is very important that how you space yourself, what kind of gestures that you use, okay, how you place your body position, leaning forward slightly, not too laid back like this, or, you know, sitting away from them. So you gently lean forward, then you have you try to maintain the eye contact and you're relaxed. Now, again, one caveat here, eye contact may be a very, again, a cultural issue. Because certain cultures, women may not be used to being stared at by men. Okay, so men may not be used to looking at women. So we need to be conscious of that cultural aspect also. So it should be something respectful. So when you're looking at the person, look at the eyes. Don't look anywhere else so that you convey that you're respectfully listening to the person. So it's important that you establish that to build the rapport with those people. So this is where you're talking with multiple people. Okay, not one person, but more than two or three people are there in front of you and you're talking to them. So it's important that you follow this, particularly in the context of mediation. And you will find that generally in any context also, this is a very useful way of, you know, dealing with things. Now, there is a field called neuro-linguistic programming. Have you heard of that, NLP?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So NLP, there's a lot of, you know, questions raised about it. Many scientists, neuroscientists say that there is no scientific basis for NLP, for neuro-linguistic programming. But there are very strong practitioners of NLP, and one of them is one of my teachers, Joel Lee, who swears by NLP. He says that NLP is a very good way of building rapport. NLP consists of both verbal and non-verbal communication. Okay. So what happens is, people are of different types, right? Now there might be somebody, let's take the situation where two people are running. So there might be some people whom you can say who will be self-motivated to run fast or run at the right pace. So they may be maintaining a steady pace or they may be running fast. So they may be motivated to do on their own selves, by their own. Now there might be some people who can be told, please run fast. So why don't you run faster? Come on, run fast. You keep telling them and then they get motivated to run. Now there might be some people, if you tell them to run fast, they may not. Where they need to run fast, they may run very slow. Where they need to maintain a constant pace, they may, you know, tend to be either very slow or very fast. So how do you deal with that? So NLP says that what is important is pacing. Pacing yourself to the speed of that person. So this is a metaphor. The running metaphor is used to explain how pacing can be done. So what you do if you want a person to run at a particular speed, you start running with that person. Okay, so you start running with that person at his or her pace. And then as the person gets used to your pace, because as you're running and both of you are running at the same pace, then that person will get used to your pace. And then when you want to either slow down or go faster and you increase or decrease your pace, automatically the other person will also increase or decrease the pace. So this is called as pacing. And pacing and leading. So what you're doing is you're first going to the speed of that person, running at the same speed, and then you start leading the person. So NLP says that even in communication, you can apply the same principle. So when somebody is very agitated and is speaking in a very angry manner and is speaking very fast, now what you do is you respond to that by nodding vigorously and shaking your head and, you know, showing the person that you're listening. So if somebody is very sad and speaking very slowly, so you adopt the pace with that person and slowly you start, you listen to that person, you nod your head slowly. Yes, yes, I understand. Yes. So then you gradually build up the pace and okay, let's see what we can do about it. Shall we discuss this? Shall we do that? So you increase the pace and you bring the person to your pace. So that is the technique that NLP practitioners use as a means of communication to build rapport with the other person. So some of the non-verbal communication for building rapport is matching. So if the person in the opposite side is sitting with the right leg on the left leg, cross-legged, with the right leg on the left leg, and with the right hand resting on the arm of the chair, you match that by exactly crossing your right leg with the left leg and resting your right hand on the arm of the chair. Or if that person is leaning forward and has, as you see in the picture, you do the same thing. Okay, so what you're showing basically, you know, when you look at that picture, don't you see that these two people seem to be interested in listening to each other, right? Now, what happens if one person is leaning like this and talking and the other person moves back and leans back? Obviously, there seems to be some disconnect between them. Okay. So when you want to listen to somebody, when you want to build rapport with somebody, what is important is you develop the rapport. I hope I'm not running out of time. Yeah. The second thing is mirroring. Okay. So you see Obama and what is this guy's name? The former Prime Minister of Britain?
Anybody James knows? Cameron. James Cameron.
James Cameron, yes. I always forget his name. So these two are walking and you see that Obama is hanging his, holding his, coat on his right shoulder. And this guy is exactly mirroring that by putting his coat on the left shoulder. Now you may think that this is all happening subconsciously, but these world leaders are trained on communication skills. So they know exactly how to mirror the other person's actions. Okay, so there is mirroring that is happening over there. And that is a way of establishing rapport with each other. Okay. And then we have what is called as a crossover mirroring. Crossover mirroring is when you, when one person is speaking very fast you are nodding as vigorously as that person, and when your turn comes, you also speak in the same way, fast, to show that you are actually sharing that same level of feelings which the other person has. So it's a good way of establishing empathy when you're talking in a manner like this. So when one person is talking and or when listening to you is nodding the head vigorously, when your turn comes, you also nod your head vigorously. So it's called as crossover mimicry. So these are all, you know, non-verbal techniques of building rapport. Now, we all have different representational systems. Like, for example, if I say dog, each one of you may be thinking of a dog in a different way. So some of you may be imagining a dog. You'll be seeing in your mind a dog. Now, some of you might be hearing the dog's barking. Now, some of you may be smelling a dog or maybe tasting the dog. Okay, maybe you think of a hot dog. Okay, so you're tasting the dog. In your mind, a dog doesn't come, but a hot dog comes. Okay, so that means you're kinesthetic. Okay, you're more of the touch and feel person. Okay, so you may be feeling the dog's fur when you're touching a dog and you're feeling the soft fur. You may be feeling that. So that is called as kinesthetic way of representation. And some of you may be just thinking of dog, D-O-G, dog, you know, the word dog. You may not be, nothing else might be coming to your mind. So that is a digital way of representation. So all human beings in different contexts, it's not necessary that one person is only a visual person all the time, or one person is only an auditory person all the time, or one person is always kinesthetic, or one person is always digital. It depends on the context again. It can keep changing in different ways. Okay, so you might, so one way of building rapport with people is by, you know, adopting the same representational systems to, so what are the, what you need to do is when you're communicating with somebody, you need to look out for those, what are called as predicates, okay. So some of the predicates that visual people use is see, view, look, find, show. So auditory people use listen, hear, sound, ask, talk. I'll give you examples of that also. So kinesthetic is grasp, hold. I'm unable to grasp what you're saying. Okay, now hold on to that thought. So people, when they use sentences like this, that means they're being kinesthetic. Okay, I'm listening to you. Okay, I hear what you say. That means they're processing it in an auditory way. So the representational system operating there is auditory. So feel, grip. So the digital people are always, you know, it seems to me, or I think, or I know, I understand, I sense that there is something wrong. So these kind of sentences are being used. So if you see visual, I have given you some examples here. So person A says, I don't see what you're saying. Now, how do you respond to that? So you always respond in a visual way. Okay, you say that, let me see if I can find a way to illustrate, okay, this better. Now, auditory, that doesn't sound right. And then you say, I hear you. So listen, let's talk through this in a different way. So you're using the same predicates. Like when the person says it doesn't sound right, he's using an auditory predicate, and you also say, I hear you, and listen, let's talk through this in a different way. So this helps to build the rapport. Okay, so kinesthetic, this doesn't feel right. So the predicate here is feeling. So this person is a very feeling person, like touch, smell, all those things. And what happens is then you say that, you know, we just haven't connected with this matter in a way that allows us to grasp the issues fully. So your response will be something which has something to do with the touch and feel sensation. So you say connected, you say grasp. So these are the predicates that you use. Digital, I don't know what you mean. Then you say, I understand. Let's think about different ways to examine this issue and make it easier to comprehend. So these are all digital things, like I understand. Okay, think, examine, comprehend. So these are all the digital aspects. Okay. I don't know why my Siri is activated. 1 minute. So, any questions so far on this? On the NLP, I'm not going too deep into NLP because it's very complex. It will take the whole, you know, day for us to discuss about NLP, and I'm not an expert in NLP. I'm just telling you how communication skills, it's important to build the rapport, and how you can build the rapport by pacing and leading. And that pacing and leading can happen through the way you physically position yourself with the other person, the way you match and mirror and crossover mirror the actions and the words of the other person, and also by going to the level of their representational systems. So if they are visual, you use words which are connected to visual. So you use words like, you know, find, illustrate, see, all these things. So if they are more of audit, those kind of words. If they are kinesthetic people and they say use words that reflect their kinesthetic approach to the issue, then you say, you know, you use those similar words like connect, grasp. So words that show some physical action or, you know, the touch and feel kind of a thing. So if they're digital people who are, you know, neither of these things, and they just talk in abstract, like I don't know or I understand. So you use those similar words. So basically this is all to build rapport. Any questions so far?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, if there is a person whom to whom we are talking, mm-hmm. and the person doesn't respond in any words, mm-hmm. and he nods, or what we will do then?
So what you're saying is you're talking to somebody and the person is not responding to you at all.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what do you think you can do possibly at that point of time? If the person is not responding, you need to understand the context, right? So you need to know why this person is not talking. It could be that there is another person present there who's intimidating this person, or this person feels threatened by the presence of that person. So in that case, what you can do is take this person away from there, or maybe take them separately to another room and talk to them. Okay, so move them away from there. Or maybe this person is unable to articulate. So we will be coming to, you know, active listening skills, where we'll be next talking about that, about how you can reach out to people who are not able to speak to you properly. So, you know, using these representational systems and using these NLP techniques also, you can build the rapport. So what is basically important in communication? When you talk about rapport, what you're talking about is trust. Why should a person not talk to you? It's because the person is not trusting you, or maybe there is some emotional block that that person is going through. So what is important is you need to understand why this person is not coming out in the open, why this person is not willing to talk. So what you need to do is relax, you know, you first relax, help that person to relax, talk about general things, light things, don't go to the topic straight away, you know, divert and talk about the weather, talk about what their likes and dislikes are, make small conversation. And that is where pacing and leading comes. So you pace yourself according to that person's responses. You follow now how this pacing and leading comes into play. So what you need to do is you need to pace yourself to that. Don't talk about the subject matter that you have come there to discuss, because you see that this person is not willing. So you pace yourself to that person's level and say that, okay, how are you feeling today? What's happening? So let's just talk about, you know, maybe ask about the family, just talk about general casual things. And then gradually, you know, build up the conversation and then bring to the subject that you wish to discuss. Once the person has developed the rapport and trust in you, and then you can build up the conversation from there. Right?
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you. Yes, sir. Thanks.
So that is why I'm talking to you about these techniques, because these techniques are important, especially where the communication is getting blocked because of different reasons. Because not everybody thinks the same. Not everybody is as comfortable as we would like them to be. Not everybody is as communicative as we would like them to be. Not everybody is as talkative as me, right? If you let me, I can go on talking for the whole day, right? Not everybody is going to do that. not everybody will be willing to do that. Okay. And they also say that empty vessels make the most noise. So some people may be so intelligent, so good that they don't feel like talking. Okay, they feel saying why is the so we are doing all these things and we are preparing to advise. So you just call up a person and say, my God, I had a very bad stomach ache today. Huh, is that so? Why don't you take this medicine? You know, this will be very, very helpful for you. And especially in this COVID pandemic, you would have seen how many doctors suddenly started cropping up everywhere, right? So we have all kinds of people coming up. People are ready to advise. People are ready to give an answer to your questions. Or even if you don't answer ask a question, they're willing to answer you. People are willing to judge you. People are willing to interrogate you. So real listening is listening to hear, not to answer. Listening to understand, not to judge. Listening to empathize, not to advise. And listening to build a rapport, not to interrogate. So these are very important things that you need to remember, that you need to listen. See, my wife was a part of an organization called Sneha. It's a suicide help organization. And people who are depressed or who are having suicidal tendencies, what they would do is they would either call or they'll come to the Sneha office, sit there and talk to the volunteers. And what the volunteers would do is simply listen to them. So they won't give them any advice. They won't tell them what is right and what is wrong. They won't tell them anything, but just listen to them. There are many people in this world who have nobody to listen. You know, they want to say so many things, but there's nobody to listen to them. So always, you know, be very grateful for your relationships, because it shows that you have people who are willing to listen to you. So what is very important in a relationship is, listen to understand, ask questions that would be relevant, not judgmental. Don't interrupt when the other person is talking. Don't give your judgment on the issue even before you've heard the person fully. And even if you've heard fully, don't give your judgment on what you think about it. And train your mind, don't be distracted, because we have a lot of mind chatter that goes on. Okay, we have this, in a human brain, I believe there are so many million thoughts that run through our mind. So we need to be able to, when you're listening, you should not be distracted by anything else. Slow down and practice silence. So sometimes when somebody is talking, that person might be overcome with emotions or maybe trying to recollect what they want to say. So if you're going to push them and you're going to start talking, that is going to distract them. They may not be able to tell you what exactly they want to say. So practice silence and look at the nonverbal cues. Okay, so this is basically what is called as active listening skills. Now, as you're talking, you need to show the other person that you're listening. Okay, it's not enough if you just keep nodding. You also need to show that you have heard and you have understood. So there are some nonverbal responses that you give, like you nod your head. And there are some also verbal responses that you give. For example, you say, okay. So these are nonverbal, these are verbal responses that you give. These are called as extenders. Okay, so you use extenders to show that you're listening. Then you ask clarifying questions. So if anything is not clear, because many times what happens is we misunderstand. Okay, we misunderstand. I'll give you a small example. During the South African freedom struggle, South Africa was ruled by Britain for a long time. During that freedom struggle, one of the freedom fighters, I'm forgetting his name, was arrested. and the court there in South Africa sentenced him to death. So he sends a mercy petition to Queen Victoria, praying for clemency, praying for to be pardoned. So Queen Victoria decides that, okay, he should be pardoned. He should be given clemency, and asks her people to, you know, send a telegram to the local authorities saying, hang him not, release him. So the words were, hang him not, release him. So a telegram is sent. Now, while sending the telegram, what happens is, hang him, release him. But then she's the queen, right? She has to speak in a very royal way, an imperial way. So hang him not, release him, she says. So the comma should have been, hang him not, comma, release him. Now the telegraph operator says, hang him, comma, not release him. So you see how a small apostrophe mark, like a comma, made a difference between a man's life and death. So when Ayman asked me about digital, about emails and all that, that is something we need to be very careful about. I'll be coming to that. So clarifying, you know, when you're listening to somebody, the person might be saying something with a different perspective, with a different meaning. And you may understand with a different meaning in a different way. Because there's a whole lot of things on this communication, like how we are all, you know, how we look at the world. We look at the world through our own perceptions. Perceptions are our filters. And sometimes what that person says may not be, what that person perceives may be different from what we perceive. And we understand it according to our perceptions. So it's always better to clarify. Can you help me to understand this better? Did you mean this when you said this? Have I understood you correctly? So asking these clarifying questions are very important. The second is reframing. Now, many times what happens is the person is conveying a message. And like, I'll give you an example. Like, for example, if a wife is sitting and complaining about her husband, she may for in all probability say, you know, sir, he just comes home. He throws his shoes on one side. He throws his clothes on one side. He has a shower and then he goes and sits and puts his legs up the center table and orders me, switches on the TV and orders me, you know, gets me some coffee. What am I? Am I his servant? What does he think he is? Is this a house or a hotel? You think I'm there to, you know, wait on him to do whatever he wants? Now, this is a whole paragraph spoken by the wife. Now, what you need to do is you need to reframe this. Okay, a very, very good example of this would be that there is a beautiful picture, a very good, beautiful painting by maybe Rembrandt or Van Gogh or Picasso or M.F. Hossein or somebody. And it is in a frame that is very old, decayed, moth-eaten, termite-eaten frame. Now, the question here is, are you, because the frame is very bad, the beauty of the picture is gone. There is a beautiful picture inside. But the picture looks faded and, you know, dull because of this frame. So the question is, are you going to throw away such an expensive and beautiful picture because the frame is bad, or are you going to take the picture out and put it in a different frame and hang it up? So your...
Can you please just change your shirt?
Can you please mute yourself, Ashok?
Your polo shirt?
Yeah, please. Thank you. So what you do is, when this message is given by the wife, there is something very beautiful there, okay? But she is, you know, all her bitterness and all her anger, frustration has come out over there. So you need to reframe. So what you do is you take the essence of that message, the beauty of that message, and you say that what you want from this relationship is acknowledgement and better communication and respect. So what you're doing is you're reframing and putting it in the context where she will be able to understand that, okay, this is what I want. And the husband will also be able to understand that, okay, this is what she wants and what I've been doing is wrong. So the reframing is a very powerful exercise, powerful technique, where you can capture the essence of the message and put it in a way which is very positive. Okay, so reflecting. So many times you need to, sometimes parties may say a particular sentence and you need to reflect it back as close as possible in the same way that they have said it, using the same words. That is because it is a part of clarifying, because that helps them to understand. When they hear their own words from somebody else, it gives them better clarity. And maybe that will give them an opportunity to, you know, change what they are saying. Summarizing, it's always good to show the people that you've understood what the crux of their message is. So you summarize whatever they have told you as briefly as possible, capturing the main crucial points of what they have said. And most important is empathetic listening. So listen with empathy. What is empathy? Now that's a whole big subject on its own. Okay, let me briefly tell you. Empathy is where you understand the other person's pain, the other person's feelings, the other person's frustration, anger. You understand that. And you step into the other person's shoes and you listen to what the other person has to say empathetically. Okay, without being judgmental about it, without offering advice, without doing anything that would show that you're not a good listener. So what is important is you listen with empathy. So maybe if I get some other opportunity, or maybe some other one of other resource persons may explain to you in more detail about what is empathy. So we come to the end of this. Now we talk about digital communication. Right? So there was this lady who was having a quarrel with her boyfriend on WhatsApp. Okay, so they were having an argument on WhatsApp. And finally, the boyfriend sent a message to her. So are we through? And she replied, yes. And then she went into depression because the relationship she thought was broken. And she became very depressed, and you know, she stopped meeting people and all that. Then suddenly, on the second day, he turns up at her doorstep, rings the bell, and when she opens it, says, "What, have you forgotten that we were supposed to have dinner today?" And then she tells him, "I thought you said we were through." He said, "No. What I meant was, are we through with the argument? I didn't mean that our relationship was through." So you see how your WhatsApp messages and emails can create a whole lot of confusion, right? And the second form of communication is what we are doing here today. Okay, I would feel much more comfortable if I have all of you around me sitting over there so that I can see how interested you are in whatever I'm blurting out here. Okay, or whatever I'm blabbering here, whether you're interested, whether it makes sense to you, whether you're listening to me or not. But now when I'm sharing the screen, I can't see any of you. And most of your cameras are off. So I don't really know whether I'm making any sense. Okay, and whether you're enjoying the whole thing or you're just feeling bored. You know, I don't know. So these are some of the... So what becomes very important is your feedback. Okay. So when questions are asked, or you asking me questions, that shows that, okay, here are at least some people who are interested and they're giving me some feedback about this. So that is why I told in the beginning that it's important that we give a feedback, we'll make it interactive. Okay. But it was not really totally interactive. Most of the talking I was doing, but usually I take at least 3 hours for talking about communication skills. So 1.5 hours is just half the time for that. So that's a challenge there. So I had to fit in a lot of things into this 1.5 hours. So having said that, now what is important in digital communication, the digital body language? I would, there's a book which I'll just put on chat, Digital Body Language by Erica Dhawan. A very interesting book which talks about how emails should be sent and received. Because what happens, many times emojis can also be misunderstood. Like, for example, If you send a folded hand emoji, the person receiving it may not know whether you're being sarcastic or you're, you know, that whether you're being deliberately, showing yourself to be humble. Again, it depends on the context. Like supposing somebody who's superior to you, your boss or somebody, sends an emoji like this. Please get this done at the earliest. And this is, it is followed like this. Now you'll keep tearing your hair and thinking, is this fellow angry with me? What is he? Is he being sarcastic? Okay, is he being, is he pulling my leg? So you don't know. So another smiling emoji along with that, or a hugging emoji next to that, but then again, hugging emoji may give a different meaning. So you have to be very careful about all these things. So something like that would help to show that, okay, I'm not being sarcastic, I'm being nice to you. Okay, it's just a request. So these are all, you know, important things that you need to keep in mind, because we saw, I never sold that horse to you, how words, written words, can be understood in a different way altogether. Okay, so the context always keeps changing, and it depends on whom you're communicating with. Are you communicating with your peers, your friends, your colleagues? How that communication should be? Are you communicating with your superiors? How that should be? Are you communicating with somebody who's below your pecking order? Okay, so there again, it changes. So you need to be very careful about what kind of language you use, because if you're sending an email to your somebody who's below you, who's your subordinate, and if you're very brief, okay, make sure that this is done by tomorrow. Now that sounds very brusque. It sounds very impolite. It sounds as if you're throwing your weight around. Okay, you're showing that, yeah, look, I'm here and you're here. So it sounds like that. So your language matters there. This seems to be needing some, you know, urgent, this needs to be urgently done. So I'll be very happy if you can do it as early as possible. Put a question mark there. And now even in emails, you can send emojis. Though very formal, like business communications, it will look odd if you send an emoji, but at least within your setup, you can do that, because it shows that, you know, you have a casual and more down to earth approach, and you're not being really the boss. You're being nice to the person. Okay. So that is something that you need to work out depending on your relationship, depending on the context in which you're communicating. So it keeps changing always. So communication is not something that is fixed. It's not something that you should do things only in this way or that way. It's something which is very flexible. So what is important if you want to master communication skills, what is important for you is you need to keep in mind two things. One is the cultural aspects, because if even within India, we have multiple cultures. You're a beautiful mosaic of so many cultures, so many, you know, ways of thinking, so many ways of doing things, so many belief systems. So what might be good for one person may not be good for the other person. So it's very important that you understand that cultural aspect. And try to, if you're not aware of the culture, of the cultural background of the other person, always go by some universally accepted standards. Okay, so don't be too friendly with somebody, supposing especially of the opposite sex, because it might be misunderstood. So it might be mistaken. So you have to be first, you know, initially very friendly, but polite and formal. So you have to, you know, work these things out in your own minds, and you have to be careful about how you're communicating. And don't be, what Erica Dhawan says, most important thing is, you're getting a message. Don't be quick with your fingers and immediately respond. Okay. Don't respond immediately. That's a mistake I used to make very often earlier until I read a book. Now I'm very careful of my responses. Okay. So what happens is, the first thought that comes to your mind, if you put it down, it may not be that, there are two, three things that can happen. One is, you may not have understood that message which you received in a proper way. Okay, it's always better to ask in that context, can you just clarify this? I'm not able to understand what you're trying to say. So no harm in clarifying. So you don't have to respond immediately. If you have understood that this message is being sarcastic or accusatory or whatever, then you wait for some time. I always talk about the neuroscience plays a lot of important role in this, because you have something called the amygdala, which is what triggers your emotions in the brain. Okay, try to read about this. You will know a lot about it. And sometimes your defense responses get triggered by something which, you know, which prima facie but look might look offensive to you. So you immediately try to hit back. Okay, you want to immediately say something nasty. So allow your amygdala to get, you know, allow your neocortex to start working, processing the information, and give a more calculated response rather than a response that would be, so especially when you're angry or when you're emotional, never indulge in written communication. William Ury, I don't know whether you heard of William Ury, he's one of the co-author of the book, Getting to Yes. You can watch his videos on YouTube. Okay, he's one of the top negotiation experts in the world. So he says, you will make one of the best speeches that you will ever regret when you're angry. So you have to be very careful, because you very eloquently and very, very flowery prose you'll use when you're very angry. But then after 5 minutes, when you look at that message, you'll regret it. Because you might have misunderstood what was being told to you, or you could have given a different response. So digital communication is where you have the luxury of tailoring your response. It's not that you're face to face with somebody and you have to immediately respond. Okay, so you can always give an excuse that, you know, I was a little tied up, or you can send a message, I'm a little tied up now, let me get back to you as soon as I can. So do that. So this helps to save a lot of heartburn. Itself helps to save a lot of misunderstandings. So it is something that, you know, these are small techniques that you can possibly use in digital communication. I hope at least to some extent I have answered your question, Naiman.
Yes, sir. You have answered it very well.
Thank you. So, okay, I think we'll conclude here. I have exceeded my time by about almost 12 minutes. So, Principal Madam should not get angry with me. Pushpuji.
Sir, my folded hands in gratitude. Nothing was
untouched. I don't want you to have the wield the cane. Right, any questions now?
I have a question, sir. This is
BC. Name? Who's this?
This is regarding eye contact.
Hello? This is
regarding eye contact, sir.
I'm not able to hear. Who's this?
Bit louder, please. This,
hello?
This is VT, sir. I think there's some network issue with that. Maybe. Any more questions for anybody?
Sir, there's one question, if I may ask.
Yes, of course. Please.
You should ask. Yeah. You should ask. You may not ask. You should ask.
When we were talking about, you were talking about the active listening part. What if a person starts speaking and is expressing overwhelming emotions? Yeah. And for a matter of fact, I tend to miss out on a particular part. How am I supposed to incline towards the clarification? Because then that might be a put off for that person that, you know, I'm expressing a particular emotion and that person is not being being able to relate to that emotion.
Okay. So now when somebody is talking very emotionally to you, okay, that is where the empathetic listening comes as part of the active listening skills. So the difference between empathy and sympathy is, like, for example, if somebody is telling me something which is very moving, okay, which is very emotional, and I say that, oh my God, really this happened to you? Well, bad, yeah, come on, how did you go through that? I'm showing sympathy. Okay, so I'm not really understanding, I'm also agreeing with what the person felt. Now, what happens when I show sympathy is that that feeling, that emotion gets more and more entrenched. Okay, so what I need to show is empathy there. So I say that obviously this has been a traumatic experience for you. So I show that I understand. Okay, and it's all about that person. So it has been a traumatic experience. So here is somebody who's acknowledging the trauma that I've been through. Right? So that person feels that, you know, my emotions have been understood. At the same time, I'm not agreeing with that person. Okay, because it is that person's experience, right? And if that person is angry, so be it. If that person is sad, so be it. He or she has a right to feel that. So I'm acknowledging that. So when I say, obviously, this, this experience has been quite traumatic to you. And you're very upset about it. Or you're very angry about it. You're very sad about it. So I label the emotion. So when I label the emotion, what happens is, see, many times when you're angry or you're sad or you're going through any of the emotions, you yourself will never, mostly you'll never be able to understand that emotion. Okay, it will be only that you're experiencing it. You'll feel, you know, when you're angry, you'll feel that you're like, you'll be speaking loudly, you'll be shouting. Many times it has happened to me. And I'll be shouting at the top of my voice and I don't realize I'm angry. And my wife says, why are you angry? And then suddenly I realize, yeah, I'm angry. No, why am I angry now? So you see how, when you label the emotion, it helps to recognize. See, these emotions are something that we feel. It is something purely physiological. But we have given them some labels. Okay, so why those labels we have given is, to help us to understand what they are. So when you're angry, you're just feeling that. Okay, you're feeling the rush of hormones. You're feeling that anger. You're feeling that clenching of the fist. You're feeling that raising of the voice. You're doing all that, but you're not labeling it. So when somebody labels it for you, the recognition comes that one, there is a recognition that yes, I'm angry. Okay, once you recognize the emotion, you feel validated, okay? Because you say that, you know, somebody is empathetically listening to you. So you feel validated. So that helps you to deal with the emotion. Okay, so it helps you to handle that emotion in a better way because now you know what it is. Okay, so virtually you've reached a diagnosis of what exactly is happening to you, right? So that is very important. That is where in active listening, we emphasize on empathetic listening and labeling of the emotion. So when you label the emotion and empathetically listen to the other person and give an empathetic response. Okay. So this situation has caused a lot of anger to you. So I see that you're very angry. So now you're not being judgmental. Your tone of voice, the way you say, the words that you use, you're not saying you're right or wrong. Okay, but you're saying that, yes, you're angry and this has caused you this emotion. So I'm able to think that, okay, I'm angry and this person is able to understand why I'm angry. Okay, so let me see what I can do about it. So that is where the pacing and leading comes. There again, if the person is still not able to overcome, you pace yourself according to that person's, the way that person behaves. Doesn't mean you get angry. But you go along with that. Okay, and then you slowly move. Okay, let's see what we can do about it. The situation seems to be very difficult for you. And shall we discuss on how we can, set right this or correct the situation? Can we talk about that? So you are now leading. So you're pacing and then leading. So that is how the NLP works over there. Thank you, Sampurna. That was a good question. Thank you. Any more questions?
Sir, I have a question related to this previous question.
Yeah.
When it's related to mediation, when you are going through the mediation, it's obviously a professional environment. So you don't want to say something like this that arises the question of conflict of interest when it comes to empathetic or sympathetic listening. Mm-hmm. So what is the significance of empathetic listening in mediation or arbitration?
See, one thing is, in arbitration, there's no question of empathetic listening, because you have two different kinds of dispute resolution processes broadly. You have adjudicatory processes and you have non-adjudicatory processes. In non-adjudicatory processes, see, in adjudicatory processes, there are a set of facts and there is the law. So you apply the law to the facts and you give a judgment on that, or you pass an award. So there's no space for this element of humanity called emotions or feelings or anything. There's no scope for that. Whereas when you come to the dispute resolution, non-adjudicatory dispute resolution processes, mediation emphasizes on emotional satisfaction. See, we have what is called a satisfaction triangle for any conflict resolution. Satisfaction has to be procedural satisfaction. It has to be substantive satisfaction, that is the outcome, whether it is something that pleases both the parties or both the parties are happy with it. And the third is emotional satisfaction. So emotional satisfaction comes only if there is an empathetic listening and scope for expressing those emotions and dealing with those emotions. Now, what we as mediators, we believe is our neutrality, the fact that we are neutral, doesn't mean that we are, we are immune to what the parties are feeling or what they're doing. So what we call it as omnipartiality. So we are partial to both the parties equally. Okay, because we are non-judgmental. We don't decide that, okay, because this person has done this, he's wrong. Or because this person has not done this, this person is right. So we don't decide that, but we understand that this is how this person is looking at it. And that's why this person has done this. So let's understand this person's perspective and understand where this person is coming from, understand how this person is feeling about it, and deal with it in that way while we deal with in the same way with the other person. So the approach towards both the people are the same. So we are empathetic to both. So we are omnipartial to both. Okay, so the question of conflict of interest doesn't come here, because if you're being sympathetic to one person and apathetic to another person, your neutrality gets compromised. Right.
Thank you so much, sir.
So that's why we say we are not judgmental at all. We don't judge. We listen to understand. So you can find out the difference. You're all going to be lawyers. You know, when we refer to a court proceeding, we say court hearing. We say the court is hearing something. We don't say the court is listening. Do we? Because what the court is hearing are dry facts. When you're listening, see, you listen to music, but you hear a sound. You see the difference between these two. You hear a sound, but you listen to music. Because you're listening to the emotion that goes into the music. You're listening to the meaning that is being conveyed through the music. But when you hear, you're listening to, you're just hearing a dry sound. Okay, something that falls on your eardrums, gets processed by your brain, and you realize that, okay, it's a cracker bursting, or a tire bursting, or a utensil falling in the kitchen, or somebody screaming, you hear. You listen, it's something much more than that. Okay, because you're listening to the meaning of what is being conveyed to you. So you're going beyond those words and you're listening. Beyond the sound.
Thank you so much. Actually, the conflict of interest was basically confusing me, that whether it has. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
No, I don't see it as conflict of interest. I see it as I'm being omnipartial with both. So no matter how bad a person is, I am nobody to judge that person in a mediation. Okay. I may judge the person if I'm not a mediator, but when I'm a mediator, I wouldn't like to judge. Okay. Let's say an abusive husband is sitting in front of me. I am nobody to judge him. Okay. Because I don't know where he's coming from. He might have had an abusive childhood. He may have gone through a trauma in his childhood and he's trying to emulate his father or his grandfather whom he has seen abusing his wife. So I don't know. I don't want to judge. But what I want to see is how I can help both of them to, you know, resolve this issue between them.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a very good session.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Yes, sir. I have a question. This is Devaki. Usually, sometimes what happens, the other, when we want to talk to the other person and communicate our view, before that, they start irritating us. They know where we get irritated by their body language, by their gestures, especially when we go to some bank. In the very beginning, the managers were very negative towards us, and they were at the wrong side. You know, even if you're, everything is correct with us, without knowing anything, they'll talk very rudely and very, not in a very good way, politely. Then usually in such circumstances, I get very irritated, very wild. And my husband keep control. No, just because they keep seeing from morning to evening, they may get saturated with so many people, mentalities and all. By the time you come, he may be at his peak angry mood or anything. Just try to calm down and all. He always try to calming down me. But everywhere, wherever I go, by their immediate body language, but the way they receive us, very in a negative way, I get very wild and angry. That way, you know, I shout at them and they just come. Like that, I'm getting so many enemies and all, and I don't feel like going to them again. Like that, I'm losing my lot of clients and customers and all like that. It happens very often with me. I don't know how to come out of this. By their angry gestures. And recently also, there was there is a man like Malik Parchuri, is a chemical engineer. And he don't know anything because I'm a medical professional from New Zealand, basically. That I'm not a social scientist and all like that. Okay. But I'm learning now. I joined in LLB. Okay. But by seeing that man talking and the way he's talking to the doctors, the way he's abusing and all, I get really so wild, you know. I just can't control the negativity and all, the way he's talking without knowing anything and all. How to come out of this? You know, it's my personal, it's a negative aspect of myself. Later on, I realize I should have ignored him. I should have calmed down and all like that. Mm-hmm. But by seeing the other person's acts and body language or gestures, mm-hmm. it makes really annoying and irritating. Mm-hmm. How to come out of this? It's really, you know, Herculean task for me.
Okay, that's a good question, actually, because most of us are like that, okay? Even, many times we get triggered. We get angry with certain things.
Yes, they'll be triggered.
Especially where what we perceive as very unreasonable or irrational or, you know, bad behavior of other people, we tend to get provoked by that. Now, what we need to understand and is what is happening to us. Okay, they are what they are. They are doing what they are doing. But what is happening to us, actually? And that is where emotional intelligence comes into play. Okay. So emotional intelligence is basically two things. One is self-restraint, how we are able to deal with our own emotions. And number two is how we are able to deal with other people's emotions. That is empathy. Okay. So self-restraint and empathy are two things that go hand in hand. One, how good are we in handling our own emotions? Now, other people's emotions are something that we cannot control, but we can handle them, right? How we are going to handle them is because first we need to handle our own emotions. So when we are going to get provoked, because, you know, again, here the neuroscience comes, how our amygdala gets triggered and how we start going into a defensive or an offensive way of responding to situations, it becomes like that. So what we need to do basically is focus on how to increase or develop our emotional intelligence. So what you need to do probably is that it's just a suggestion. You can, you know, you may come up with better ways of dealing with it. What you need to do is when you're getting angry, when you're getting provoked, before you say something, just take a mental step back. Take a few deep breaths. Relax yourself. And your husband has given you a very good tip. He says that maybe, you know, they have been working the whole day, so there might be some reason for them to behave like this. So,
yes, sir, always.
Yeah, so think about that. Feel empathetic towards that person who is behaving badly with you. and then talk politely to that person and see whether the person's response changes. Because if you're going to get angry when the other person is angry, you're going to only escalate the situation to something which is worse.
So put away the nose,
step back, take a deep breath, take a few breaths. See, neuroscience has shown that whenever any provocative or any danger, signal of any danger or anything comes to our brain, it travels through our sensory organs and reaches the thalamus. And from the thalamus, there are two routes it takes. One, which is a very short route to the amygdala and a longer route to the neocortex. So what happens is our reptilian brain, the amygdala, starts acting fast immediately. And the neocortex takes a few seconds to start reasoning and start rationalizing. In the meantime, what happens? The amygdala hijacks and prevents our neocortex from thinking or processing that information rationally. So what we need to do is, if you must have heard our elders telling us, when you're angry, count till 10. Okay, so they always say count till 10 because that's the time which you give for your neocortex to start thinking rationally and processing the information. And people compare this emotional mind and rational mind to a mahout who's sitting on an elephant. So the emotional mind is the elephant, the rational mind is the mahout. So if the mahout is not able to control the elephant can go berserk and cause a lot of damage. So what is important is for the mahout to control the elephant. So you need that time to process the information, to think about it, breathe deeply, relax, and then you respond, your response will be much better.
Javasa, Manjira here.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Javasa, Manjira here, actively listening to your class.
Thanks, Manjira.
Actually, what happened, Devaki is our student. Her daughters have been settled well in London or somewhere New Zealand with her. They are top doctors, but still she is an active student in our college. The guidance what you have given, she has to think and react now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Tangachan has said that he used to listen to Suma before, now he hears her. So there is an old joke about that, you know. So when we met and fell in love, I used to talk and she used to listen. Okay, then we progressed in our love and she used to talk and I used to listen. Then
both
we got
ways.
Married. We got married. The priest talked and we listened. After the marriage, she talked and I listened. And now we are 10 years after marriage, both of us talk and the neighbors listen.
Carry on, good luck.
Okay. No, this is a joke. It doesn't happen to me. I don't talk at all, sir.
Yeah, I know, sir.
All right, so I think the queries of my young friends are over. And... So Jawahar sir, thanks a lot for sparing your valuable time and spending it with our young friends. And I'm sure there is a lot of material for my young friends to think over for today, the discussion which we had on the topic. And I'm hopeful that it was more of an active listening than hearing by my young friends. So if they had actively listened it, they must have understood it also. So thank you, friends. And thank you, Jawahar sir. Thank you, Push ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chan sir, for arranging this Zoom meeting for all of us. So can we say goodbye to all of you?
Yeah, thank you, friends, for listening to me so politely and so nicely all the time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much. Thank you. Take care.
Thank you so much.
Then with your permission, let me close the session.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you once again, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Push, for the opportunity. Pushpa and Tangachan and Anoop, thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Joseph.
Thanks to Anoop. Thank you, Pallavi. Thank you.
Thank you so much, man. Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks for the wonderful session.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.